Welcome to this presentation series on care for rural physicians. This project was created by the Association of Faculties of Medicine of Canada with funding by the Canadian Physician Health Institute. The Canadian Physician Health Institute is dedicated to improving the health of Canadian physicians and is the result of cooperative participation between the Canadian Medical Association and the Canadian Medical Foundation. Each presentation in this series is available online as a podcast and can be accessed at afmc.ca. Throughout this series, you will be hearing from leading professionals specializing in addiction and mental health. Reflective questions and other resources will be highlighted in a supplementary guide available with the podcast. Today's presentation is by Dr. Peter Butt, the Medical Director of the Department of Family Medicine at the University of Saskatchewan. Physician Health Program at Saskatchewan Medical Association. Welcome, Dr. Butt.
Thank you for the opportunity to present to you today. I'm the chair of the Physician Health Program at the Saskatchewan Medical Association, as was mentioned, but really have no conflicts of interest otherwise. Obviously a bias, but no conflicts of interest. What I'd like to do today is to take you through a review of the Saskatchewan context for rural and regional physicians so we can understand the nature of rurality in this province, and then shift to learning about the presenting concerns for rural versus urban physicians within our physician health program. I'd like to explore their similarities and differences, and then with you reflect on the challenges for appropriate support and access to services and how they might be met by a physician health program. To start then, any of you who have visited the province have probably done so on the Trans-Canada Highway. This is a typical bucolic view that you would see of farmsteads trying to stay awake as you drive from Winnipeg through the flat prairie landscape to eventually Calgary. It's a struggle, I know, and unfortunately this doesn't reflect the reality of the province. There's much hidden behind the scenes. Much hidden in terms of people's activities, the diversity of the province, and the opportunity for people to innovate and respond to the challenges, not only presented by the environment, but of course by the social geography. And I'd just like to touch on the context so you have an appreciation of what we're dealing with when we talk about the Saskatchewan context. At 651,000 square kilometers, it's slightly larger than the country of France. 10% is covered by lakes, something which isn't communicated by the typical prairie pictures that you will see. There's transitional geography from the Great Plains to the south, through to the parkland in the central part of the province, on into the boreal forest and the western edge of the Canadian Shield. So as you can see in the pictures, there's badlands, there's grasslands, predominantly in the south, there's parkland as we transition from the agricultural zone into the boreal forest, which is Precambrian Shield, covered by lakes and rocky outcroppings. Within this geography, there's only 1.2 million people, relatively small population for a landmass the size of France. Only two cities exceed 200,000. That would be the capital, Regina, and Saskatoon, where I'm speaking to you from today. There are three regional centers, two that are somewhat larger at about 30,000 population or slightly more, and three in the 15,000 to 20,000 range. The remainder of the population are in even smaller rural and remote communities. Some of these remote communities do not have road access. With regards to the healthcare setting, there are 13 regional health authorities that provide integrated healthcare in the province. All health services are integrated under these regional health authorities, and in them, services are provided by some 2,300 physicians. This is College of Physicians and Surgeons of Saskatchewan statistics, with over 50% of those 2,300 physicians international medical graduates. When we look at the urban-rural split, 68% or 1,573 are urban-based. 735 are based in rural and remote areas, or 31% of the physician population. when we look at the specialist family physician split, 1,255 or 54% of the specialists are specialists, whilst 1,053 are family physicians. That would be 46%. There are, when we move now to the regional and rural context, there's a relatively small number of solo or less than four physician practices. Over the last 10 to 20 years, there's been an effort to amalgamate those solo practices into larger groups, typically based with regional hospitals and offering satellite clinics to the much smaller rural communities. This decreases the professional isolation and the social isolation of those physicians and ensures that they have adequate support. There's increasing integration of family physicians into various models of primary care. These are regional health authority initiatives that incorporate family physicians perhaps on a stipend or on a salary or on a sessional basis. Some are otherwise fee-for-service. Given the significant number of international medical graduates, what the province has developed is the Saskatchewan International Physician Practice Assessment Program. This is required for licensure in the province, and those international physicians that are interested in practicing in Saskatchewan would apply to the program. If they meet the credential requirements, they will be offered a seat, and they must successfully pass this combination of orientation and assessment in order to gain licensure in the province. It slows the process of integrating international medical graduates into our physician population, but it does so in a way that has them better prepared for practice at the end. So let's turn to the more burning question that we have here and the purpose of our webinar today. And essentially, is there a difference in the healthcare needs of rural physicians versus urban physicians based on their presentation to a physician health program? There are some differences, and I'd like to explore those with you. But first, let's look at the contacts that are made to our physician health program. This represents all contacts with the physician health program from those physicians who we would consider rural and regional. 46% present with concerns that would fit a mental health or psychiatric category. Mental health, of course, is very broadly defined in terms of stress and transitional or other adjustment challenges. 27% of contacts with our PHP are with regards to occupational issues, concerns with regards to their workplace, adjustment perhaps, and so on. 15.3% are family concerns, whilst 11.5% deal with substance use disorders. Is this different than what we see amongst our urban colleagues? With regards to those urban contacts, we see 48% inquiring with regards to mental health or psychiatric concerns, 16.8% occupational, 14.3% family, 8.4 substance use disorders, and 3.4 more of a physical or cognitive concern. If we put those into a bar graph to compare them, you can see that there's slightly more mental health and psychiatric concerns arising amongst the urban as opposed to the rural and remote physicians. However, a significantly more number of the rural and remote physicians are concerned about occupational issues vis-a-vis urban. They're very close in terms of family concerns, although slightly increased amongst the rural and remote cohort. Substance use disorders are significantly more of a concern in rural and remote areas. However, physical and cognitive issues are more of a concern in urban areas. So there is a shift up and down when we compare the two populations. So what are the rural and remote challenges to summarize those statistics? Occupational concerns are greater in rural remote areas, as are substance use disorders. However, with regards to urban physicians, physical and cognitive issues exceed the rural and remote areas, as do mental health and psychiatric ones. Let's explore those variances and try to understand them in our context. Let's turn first to occupational issues. There's certainly increased clinical demand to provide a greater breadth, depth, and availability of services in rural and remote areas, typically drawing on a predominantly family physician pool. Nevertheless, there's a smaller physician pool to provide coverage and skills. When we consider those demands placed upon the rural and remote physician workforce, we also have to pair that with a constrained regional health authority administrative skill set with potentially poor management of problems and conflicts. I don't want to damn anyone across the board. Certainly, we see some very strong, innovative management and administrative initiatives coming from rural and regional health authorities. But certainly, they're asked, just like our physicians are asked, to cover a broader base with a smaller number of people and often a more constrained administrative skill set. We also need to layer in some of the occupational issues faced when over 50% of our rural and remote physicians are international medical graduates with adjustment challenges for both themselves and their families. There are also contextual reasons with regards to the increased number of concerns with regards to substance use disorders arising in rural and remote areas. There's professional and personal stress, as I alluded to, in terms of the increased demand for the breadth and depth of skills required when there's a smaller physician pool. There's significant professional and personal isolation experienced in small communities. There's also reduced alternative recreational activities, curling, hockey in the winter, snowmobiling, perhaps cross-country skiing, snowshoeing, and so on. But certainly compared to the city where there's more arts and culture, there's reduced alternative recreational activities. Layer in a heavier drinking culture in rural and remote areas, and you can see a setup for problematic substance use, particularly alcohol use disorders. What about the difference between physical and cognitive challenges? It would make sense, however, when you think about older physicians relocating to urban practices to slow down and retire, that you would have a shift away from the busy cut and thrust of rural and remote care to perhaps a mediclinic or a slower pace where on-call is perhaps non-existent and the skill set is more constrained. So certainly there would be a shift from rural areas to more urban areas of older physicians, where they have more amenities, greater practice flexibility, and lower acuity of care. The mental health issues that we see being higher in urban rather than rural areas is perhaps surprising, also given the fact that the substance use disorder data is somewhat reversed. This may, however, be a selection bias, with those with pre-existing mental health issues less likely to select the demands and professional isolation and perhaps increased social scrutiny of a smaller rural community. So how do we provide services to such a diverse population, very rural and remote population of physicians within a physician health program? We have a somewhat unique structure in that within the Saskatchewan Medical Association, there are several physician support programs provided, a member advisory committee that supports physicians that are going through regulatory challenges, a medical benevolence society that provides funding to physicians who are financially challenged, and then the Saskatchewan Physician Health Program, which is the primary focus of our discussion today. The history of the physician health program is similar to that of other jurisdictions, where it originated back in the 70s as the Saskatchewan Physicians at Risk Committee, or SPARC, which was comprised of 11 volunteer physicians that were motivated to help physicians with substance use disorders. This was a joint committee of the Saskatchewan Medical Association and the College of Physicians and Surgeons from 1987 to 1999. and its primary role, as mentioned, was the identification of addiction problems and educating physicians with a substance use disorder. So it was intended to provide interventions, to motivate physicians struggling with a substance use disorder to seek treatment, and provide aid in acquiring appropriate treatment programs and encouraging them to continue in their recovery programs once they return to work. Very much substance use oriented. In 1997, Spark expanded its scope to include its services as a resource to physicians who have also been impaired by physical illness, mental illness, aging, as well as problems related to family function, sexual functioning, primarily boundary issues, medical practice, financial or legal challenges. And also to contribute to the ongoing education of the profession with respect to learning and informing colleagues about current trends in mental health and addiction issues. So this was an expanded scope that led to a renaming of the committee from Saskatchewan Physicians at Risk to the Physician Health Program. In 2001, by mutual agreement, the committee became a committee of the SMA solely, with the departure of the College of Physicians and Surgeons from the Oversight Board. In 2003, funding was secured to hire a full-time director, and PHP funds were provided through an endowment independent of membership dues. Due to the decrease in returns in that endowment fund and an expansion in the activities of the committee, membership dues will be an increasing source of revenue for the program. But we were very fortunate to have a separate endowment fund to establish the foundation. In 2004, Spark changed its name to the Saskatchewan Physician Health Program to reflect the expansion of its mandate and services. And the program also provides services to medical students, residents, physicians, and their family members. So this could include children, spouses, common law spouses, and so on. So we have a fairly broad and inclusive mandate in which we work to meet the needs of the physician community within the province. How do we handle the referral process? Well, calls may come in predominantly to the director, but also to occasionally committee members. And a triage process is established with regards to designating them as contacts where information is provided, or indeed a further assessment where a file may be opened requiring further intervention, perhaps a contract in monitoring. So the contacts involve a request for education, perhaps a professional consultation, or facilitating a referral to a community-based resource for service. It doesn't require opening a file for further assessment, treatment, or monitoring. And what our director does is, or has done, is essentially established a province-wide virtual EAP, if you will, with a network of contacts that physicians can access independent of the program for themselves or their family members. These are contacts or a network of individuals that are professional, confidential, and comfortable providing services to the physician community. If, however, a further interview is deemed necessary, two members of the committee will meet with the physician and possibly their spouse. And if the physician is receptive and it's necessary, an appropriate plan will be developed and a contract entered into to monitor progress. So obviously these are issues of higher acuity than what one would see dealt with at a purely contact level. However, sometimes the physician is not receptive to care, and then the committee has to consider the acuity of the problem. If there's concern for the physician, but no significant concern for patient safety, the committee will continue to offer assistance as appropriate, or perhaps consider termination unless they contact us again. If there is concern for the physician, the problem creates a concern for patient safety, we are obligated to notify the physician that the matter will be referred to the registrar of the College of Physicians and Surgeons. We have a duty to report in Saskatchewan. And as much as we We endeavor to keep our physician contacts non-nominal. If, however, there's a concern for patient safety, we will report. But we let the physicians know this. And within the contact process, we tell the physicians that if they're self-referred and wish to pursue further support, that they will remain non-nominal. And indeed, people have gone through a whole process of assessment and treatment and aftercare remaining non-nominal. However, if they're referred, reporting back is required, and I'll comment on that further. So if you see this process map, the individual may come in, they may be self-referred, treated as a contact, and receive information, education, or a referral to other professional consultation. If a file is required to be opened because of the severity of the problem, there's an initial interview. If a person remains self-referred, then they remain non-nominal. Through that initial interview process, if the person is receptive, a treatment plan is developed, and support and monitoring is required, as required. And this may require further referral to a treatment program or center. If the individual is not receptive and there are no patient safety concerns, assistance is offered, but if it's not taken up, there may be termination of the contact. If the individual is not receptive to intervention and treatment, but there are patient safety concerns, they're referred to the College of Physicians and Surgeons. Typically, our College of Physicians and Surgeons would have a fireside chat with the individual and refer them back as a formal referral from the College of Physicians and Surgeons, which requires reporting back to the college with regards to progress. So there is an interview. A consultant assessment may be required. Recommendations are made by the consultant. There may be a contract with support and monitoring. And recommendations purely based upon the reporting purely based upon the recommendations and contract if they're formally referred by the College of Physicians and Surgeons, a regional health authority, or the College of Medicine. Otherwise, there's no reporting back. I think I'd like to pause on this point and reemphasize that the reporting back is purely based upon the recommendations of the assessment and the recommendations with regards to the contract support and monitoring. The details are not shared. Those are kept confidential. So what about the support and monitoring that's provided by the Physician Health Program? Well, clearly there's an identification of the issues requiring support and monitoring. Goals are established. We identify the support and monitoring process that will be put in place, establish a reporting structure to the committee, and determine a reasonable endpoint of that support and monitoring, typically 3 to 5 years in the case of a substance use disorder, but it varies greatly depending upon the recommendations that arise from the assessment. The committee is an oversight committee. However, some of the committee members will become directly involved with the physician and family member and will report in the progress to the committee for the duration of the monitoring process. They keep separate and apart the confidential patient information that they may be privy to, and simply report as any other person who's contributing to the care of a physician a brief summary of progress in treatment and whether or not they're congruent with recommendations. The committee will evaluate the reports, assess the progress of the physicians, and make further recommendations with regards to ongoing care if there's a struggle. We maintain a confidential file, but report in a non-nominal manner, unless, of course, the individual is referred. We report to the College of Physicians and Surgeons for possible intervention if there are patient safety concerns as required, and also report back to the College of Physicians and Surgeons with regards to progress of people that have been referred by that regulatory body. And finally, we will terminate the monitoring and support process as appropriate as people fulfill the terms of the contract and are more fully integrated into care. We also can provide financial support through the Medical Benevolent Fund. And our goal is to ensure that no physician will be denied access to service based upon inadequate financial resources. So if a physician needs funding to access a neuropsychological assessment, to access a treatment center, for instance, for a substance use disorder, there's financial support available. There's also assessments and consultations made available fee for service at no cost to the physician. What we endeavor to do with these consultations and assessments is to have the family physician formally refer the physician to the consultant and have it covered through the provincial healthcare system. The Saskatchewan Medical Association, however, will cover psychological counseling fees for students and residents as required. What we find is that, although this is open-ended, typically students and residents are moving through an adjustment process, a transitional process, and several sessions are all that they frequently require, unless, of course, they have a mental health diagnosis that requires ongoing psychiatric care. The other point that I would like to make in terms of financial support is an agreement that Saskatchewan Health, the Medical Services Branch, which funds physician services, and the Physician Health Program have a funding agreement so that physicians in need of addiction treatment for a substance use disorder can attend Edgewood and Nanaimo, and the province will cover 52 days of rehab. This is therefore poses no financial burden except for the transportation to the physician to get to Nanaimo. The cost of monitoring is also covered by the Saskatchewan Medical Association and the Medical Services Branch through confidential community-based practices. So typically we will use a network of family physicians who will collect urine drug screening samples. They'll be processed confidentially, much like HIV lab results, with coding, and that information is shared with the director of the Physician Health Program through the collecting physician. In this way, we have physicians who are required to have monitoring, even in rural and remote communities, can have access. So the strengths that we'd like to promote through our Physician Health Program is the availability of services through direct contact and use of distributed consultants throughout the province. Access is important, and we have a strong cooperative relationship with the Ministry of Health to ensure access to care, and in particular, treatment for substance use disorders. There's also support in terms of financial assistance through the Medical Benevolent Fund, which ensures lack of financial means does not impede access to assessment and treatment. And finally, we have the Member Advisory Committee to provide support to physicians through regulatory or occupational conflicts. So this is to ensure that there is due process followed. We believe in advocacy, but not blind advocacy. We simply want to ensure that due process is there when a problem arises with regards to billing, professionalism issues, and so on. The other is to provide a continuum of care in terms of outreach and engagement, preventative services in terms of health and wellness sessions to students, residents, physicians, and family members, through to support at transitional points in their career or difficulties that families may be encountering at different points, as well as lower level access to services all the way through to more formal assessments, treatment, and monitoring as required. So a basket of services that provides a continuum of care we feel is important to physicians who otherwise might be quite isolated in rural and regional areas. So that really brings us to the end of the road of this presentation. You have my coordinates there if you wish to contact me directly. And I thank you for your attendance today and your interest in this topic.
Thank you, Dr. Butt. We hope that the participants have enjoyed this presentation on care for rural physicians. As a reminder, this presentation and all other presentations in this series will be made available as podcasts and can be accessed at afmc.ca for you to share with your colleagues. This project was created by AFMC with funding from the Canadian Physician Health Institute.